and welcome to today's Viterbi Live featuring the one and only Dean Yannis Yortsos. My name is Tiffany Tay, and I am the Executive Director of Annual Giving and Alumni Relations here at the USC Viterbi School of Engineering. We started this Viterbi Live series at the start of the pandemic stay-at-home order to bring timely, relevant research to our engineering community, and I hope that you were able to join us for a few. If not, they have all been recorded and are available to you at our online events series page, which we will post in the chat box. Today, we welcome Dean Yortsos as he uses his extensive background as a chemical engineer to present a model for the spreading of epidemics based on an analogy with chemical reaction and diffusion processes. Did I say that right, Yannis? The model, the model accounts for spatial effects, including the emergence of contagion waves currently missing from the standard SIR models. There will also be a live Q&A portion at the end of the event. So please, during the presentation, enter all questions in the Q&A box and we'll be sure to answer them. So without further ado, Dean Yannis Yortsos.
Thank you very much, Tiffany, and a warm welcome to all of the attendees of this seminar here. I'm very pleased to be able to present some of our most recent work in this area. I am a chemical engineer. I have nothing to do with epidemiology. At the same time, I think this is a very these very interesting times that we're living in. I call for people from different expertise to come in and weigh in on the subject. And you know, about the beginning of March, they had no interest or idea of how epidemics spread. Well, I had interest, but not certainly an idea. And then after this epidemic, pandemic came to be a very important part of our lives, I was started thinking about how one can model this spreading. And I, you know, there were a number of models out there, and I was start thinking about the possibility of perhaps looking at them from a different perspective. And the perspective that I was to bring into the problem is, of course, from my training as a chemical engineer. And we do a lot of, have done a lot of work in this field of how chemical reaction processes, the reaction rates, the way they diffuse and all that. And I thought maybe this is a very good opportunity to apply to this particular problem as well. So around Memorial Day weekend, I spent my weekend trying to think of these ideas. And then after that, I partnered with my colleague here at the Viterbi School, Vice Dean Asad Oberai, who is not in this call today. He had a meeting to attend, unfortunately, but we worked together along with one of his students to actually formalize a little bit our description. So my presentation today will show you some of the results that we obtained. And we believe that we are making a non-trivial contribution to the field. And I will hopefully be able to take you through this fun ride that we had. We wrote a paper which we submitted actually for publication about a couple of weeks ago. So we'll see how the community will react to it. So right now, the paper is available in a public archive, but at the same time, I wanted to give you a preview of this through this presentation today. So if I may start by sharing my screen, then I will be able to. Okay, so let me go here for a moment. Sorry, it takes a while here. I'm just gonna share my screen. Okay. And okay. So this is the title of our work, Modeling Epidemics as Chemical Reaction Processes. Actually, we are offering a more detailed version of the things that we do here at Viterbi in something we call Viterbi versus pandemics. So this is something that we are discussing in a series of lectures, and I will show you what this series of lectures are. So I spoke last week on Thursday to modeling epidemics as chemical reaction processes today, later this afternoon at 6 p.m., there is a lecture by professors Ivan Bermejo Moreno, Engolfopoulos, and Lujar on the fluid dynamics of the spread of COVID. So we're trying to address the whole, the complete aspect of the process from the perspective of fluid dynamics, the perspective of biology, is a talk by Professor Armani the week after, and so on and so forth. So there's a lot of interesting presentations here, and shows the work that the Viterbi faculty have done to understand, combat, and be able to address technological issues for associated with the spread of COVID. In many ways, there's a lot of things that engineers can offer here, and I believe maybe after this presentation today, you will realize that actually we have a lot of interesting things to offer here, and hopefully, I think, be able to address this issue from a different perspective and give people the understanding that may be missing, or perhaps can benefit from additional perspectives. So why is this problem amenable to a chemical reaction analog? The most fundamental aspect, the most fundamental important aspect of this is that this is a contagion that is spread from human to human contact. So if you think about it, and let's make this very naive idealization that a human is essentially a chemical molecule, and that these chemical molecules therefore interact with each other. That's a human to human. And there are different human species. One species are people that are not infected, but they are susceptible to infection. Another species are people that are infected, and therefore they can infect the susceptible people. And the third species will be people that have been infected and either recovered or perished. So a minimal requirement for any such process to understand it will be to include three categories of populations of people: people that are susceptible, but they are not infected, people that are infected and they can infect others, and people that are recovered, and this we assume that are not infecting susceptible people in the future, although one can include secondary infections if we want to. But for the purpose of being minimalistic about the description, we're going to use this type of three species. This is also called the SIR model, and it's been around for a long time. However, we believe that the way people have used it has been incomplete. Why is that? Because the way it has been modeled is by looking not at the most important variable, which is the number of people per unit area, essentially the density of people, because the key to infection is proximity. Proximity means that there has been some distance to worry about. And this is also true in the spatial distancing health guidelines that people are using. The traditional models, at least the ones that I have seen, only talk about numbers, number of susceptible, infected, and recovered people, but not the numbers per unit area, the density or the spatial density. And therefore, I believe that this important parameter has to be included. And by making an analogy with reaction, chemical reaction processes, one can do this exactly, can do exactly that. And then we need to understand the rates by which infected people infect susceptible, or infected people become recovered. And again, there are possible ways to add additional demographics. You can include, let's say, age demographics, and can for example, take susceptible people and break them down by demographics, or asymptomatic, infected people that are asymptomatic or quarantine, and so on and so forth. This model will not do this, although we can extend it to capture all these much more complicated details. So what is that we're trying to do? We're going to say that infection is essentially the first reaction here that you see. Susceptible people coming in contact with infected people, and this creates two infected people. I think that's a fundamental aspect of the human-to-human contagion, and therefore we have to understand the reaction rates, how this reaction goes from here to here. By the way, these reactions are irreversible. They don't go backwards. We cannot go from infected back to susceptible and infected. It's just simply a forward reaction that does not have a reversible path. The second reaction is, if you are infected, how you recover, and that's actually the a parameter that has been in discussion a lot, you know, the potential of creating new pharmaceuticals and so on and so forth. We will present a methodology that accounts for all these kinetics, and then one potentially could then accelerate reactions of this type, decelerate or arrest reactions of this type. So what's our analogy? With all due respect, to make sure that, you know, we are not exaggerating here. So this is not a cartoon type of analogy, but I think it is very useful on how we can deal and model the process. So let's assume that these various subpopulations, susceptible, infected, recovered, and others I mentioned as asymptomatic and many others as well, are essentially different chemical species. I'm not saying that's oxygen and hydrogen, but certainly they're different chemical species. Let's assume then also that we map molecular concentrations, which is a very typical thing that we do in any chemistry or chemical reaction engineering process, where the most important thing is how many molecules exist in a given volume, that's a concentration. And we map this to number densities, which is people per unit area. Infection, so the difference is that in the molecular concentrations, the importance is volume. In the case of epidemics, the important density is area, because we are essentially living in a two-dimensional world. Infection rates will map into chemical reaction rates. And the advantage of a description like this is that we can also add mobility terms. We can add advective and diffusive fluxes. These are ways by which people move, let's say by transportation, that's the advective part, or they diffuse or disperse by random walks or other things that people do in their ordinary life. And we can actually put this together in the form of perhaps an equivalent diffusion term. So by modeling the process like this, we allow for the following important things: number densities, and I want to keep emphasizing this, as well as including transport, in this case, let's say diffusion or advection, mobility. So if we do all that, then the general model, so I will apologize with the equations. So you can close your eyes if you don't need to worry too much about them. But let me say that, you know, those of you who are familiar with how we put together equations, this essentially says that if you have N, this is the density of species I, this is moving because of advection, N of diffusion, and then it reacts as well. If this is, let's say, N of species S, this is like the susceptible, again, the same thing as well. And this is a form for diffusion. This is not, all this is not important. You don't need to worry about all these details, you know, but this is the methodology and the toolbox that we have to go ahead and solve the equations and be able then to model the process. I should mention that the traditional SIR model does not have advection, does not have diffusion. So these parts are missing from the traditional SIR model, which is actually something that I, from what I understand, most epidemiologists are using. And again, I don't want to say that I know more or better than epidemiologists, but certainly from my perspective, how one would model this process would have to include this part as well, because it's integral part of what we do in any reaction process modeling. So these are essentially the terms that I just mentioned. We also have the fact that the three densities, susceptible, infected, and recovered, the total density of the people in a particular area. And here we assume also all the coefficients of diffusion are the same. Again, these are details that you can relax or you can improve upon later on. It's not important for the things that we will mention in the subsequent parts of this lecture here. I wanted to also mention that even though the reason I put all these equations is to basically tell you that there are very, so you have a solid background to build a very solid model. Most of my presentation later on will be on figures and illustrations to make sure that people I don't want to emphasize the equation part. I want to emphasize the results part. So you have to trust me that the results that we show reflect the fundamental equations of what I have before here. The most important question is, how do you model the reaction rate? And there is a principle in chemical processes which is called mass action kinetics. Essentially, it says the following. If you have a reaction, the reaction rate, let's say S plus I that I had before, the kinetic says that the reaction rate is proportional to the concentration of one species times the concentration of the other one. So this is the product of these two concentrations. This is also used in the traditional SIR model, but they don't talk about concentration. They talk about numbers of people. And I believe this is not as a detail as it should be. What matters is not the numbers. What matters is the density. And that's, if I have 10 people that are distant over distances of 100 feet each, that is not going to be the appropriate reaction rate. However, if I have 100 people, they're all in a room of 500 feet, square feet, that will be a big problem because this number is going to be pretty high. And I think that's one of the things that is missing from the conventional description of the spreading of epidemics. So here I have the infection rate. So this appear both at the rate of infection and at the rate of infection here. This is how many new infected people come in. This is how many new infected susceptible people become infected. And then we have also the rate of recovery or the perish rate, depending on what the mortality you have. And then this is essentially another parameter, lambda, which is the recovery or perish rate. So if I look at what parameters I have in the model, there are important parameters. One is the diffusion coefficient, another is the velocity. I would say in advance that this model right now, we will just not worry about advection and we simply consider diffusion. And the other kinetic parameters are K. This is the parameter of the rate of infection, the kinetics of infection, and the parameter lambda, which is the recovery rate. And that depends a lot on, let's say, what kind of care you receive, the pharmaceuticals you receive, things that can help you get better, right? So we have a rate that says, this is how infection happens, and this tells you how fast it happens. And then you have another parameter, lambda, that says how fast you recover. So, some notes. Let's talk about lambda. Lambda is typically taken to be 1/14 days. So it has an inverse time dependence. So each dimension is 1/ time. And essentially is the rate on the average by which infected individuals recover or perish. And so this is a number that depends almost exclusively on medicine, pharmaceuticals, healthcare. So this is a number that we can't change a lot unless we do progress in the way by which we take healthcare of the people. So we're going to assume it to be 14 days inverse, which is actually what we're doing, 1/14 days. A most important parameter, however, is K, which is the kinetic, the rate by which people are infected. This also has dimension 1/ time and 1/ number per unit area. Look at this very important parameter because it includes the total density, rather the density of infected and susceptible, because this is the real density that controls the interaction between people, and this is how the infection happens, right? Again, area is an important part because contagion is negligible below a certain density. I think this is what people tell us, that if you are at a distance of 6 feet or more, then the reaction rate for this will be zero. And this is why spatial distancing is recommended. Is this true or not? Actually, the lecture that will be given later today in the evening, our faculty have done fluid mechanics simulations and experiments to show what is the safe distance that, and whether it corresponds to 6 feet or not. And whether it's 6 feet or maybe 10 feet or 5 feet or whatever it is, will be a number, let's call it, corresponding to a density we call rho zero. So we will take K, the kinetic parameter, to have this very unusual dependence. It is zero if the density is less than a certain density, which is the spatial density. and it is not zero and increases with density, if rho, the spatial density of the infected and susceptible, is higher than rho zero. I have not seen this kinetics before. Certainly in chemical reactions, we don't have K to have this zero dependence. So this is new as far as I'm concerned. And it essentially reflects the fluid mechanics of the contagion, which actually is kind of interesting that you have this different type of kinetics. But the most important part is that this parameter K depends on density. And that's an important thing to keep in mind. And I don't believe this has been articulated in the past by models that exist in the literature. Essentially, what this tells you, it is meaningless to provide area-wide averages, let's say states or countries, without differentiated on density. Because, let's say, high density situations, like more urban communities, stadiums, schools, retirement homes, and the like, are going to have a higher density, which means a higher probability of infection. Whereas lower density, let's say more rural areas, farms, and so on and so forth, are likely to have lower density. It is possible that that density makes this to go, oops, go to zero, for example. I'm sorry, I keep pushing the wrong buttons here. And so this is something that we're going to use and essentially make the point that density is an important part. The diffusion coefficient assumes that we do a random walk. You know, most of the times we don't randomly move around, but let's assume you're in an office and you randomly, you know, you say you work at your office, then you get up, you get some coffee and you move around. You can make a quick calculation for this parameter D, which is a diffusion coefficient. And in fact, if you do this calculation, you find that it's two orders of magnitude larger than if it was simply molecular diffusion in gases. So here we make an anthropomorphic interpretation of actually a chemical interpretation of anthropomorphic movement. This could be actually larger if, as part of diffusion, we also include transportation, people going from place A to place B. You know, there's a spreading, right, of people that move around. I think we can measure that. And from that, you can then calculate some sort of an equivalent diffusion coefficient. I don't think it's actually very much out of the ordinary, although understanding how humans move and what is the relationship to, let's say, physics or chemistry, it's kind of a fascinating topic. That's something that I have been interested in for a while. So this is a scary set of equations. Again, you can close your eyes. You don't have to pay too much attention to it. But this is essentially an important, so I like to emphasize three quantities. S is the normalized density of the susceptible people. It says essentially, what's the probability if I randomly pick up someone in, let's say, in my community, this person is not infected or he's not been infected yet. I is what is the probability that if I were to randomly select a person, this person has been infected. And R is the probability this person not only has been infected, but has recovered, or that person has perished, okay? So essentially we're going to have that S plus I plus R is equal to one. And so these are all normalized with the density, overall density in this particular area, we call it rho. And so these are all dimensionless numbers. From those of you who know how we proceed in these cases, we always want to make things dimensionless because this, from this dimensionalization process, we come up with the important variables. And the important variables or dimensionless numbers are something which is called the Damkohler number here. I'm not going to use this in the remaining of the presentation. So don't worry about the convective part, but we need to worry about what we call C here. It's kind of a diffusion number. You see this parameter here is a diffusion divided by some characteristic length. This length could be, let's say, the extent of a city, the diameter of a city, or let's say, would be if you have, let's say, a nursing home, would be the area where the distance over which, or the area of the nursing home. Lambda, remember, is the parameter of recovery. So this is an important parameter here and enters in this transport coefficients for diffusion in all these places here. But the most important parameter is what is known as R naught. So you can see that this R naught parameter comes very naturally from our calculation here. R naught depends on the kinetics, K zero or K naught, lambda, which is the parameter, the reaction by which people recover, density, a very important part, and the extent of contagion, because you know the more people have been infected, the less people are available for infection later on. So we expect that R naught does not stay constant in an infection process, but actually changes as part of that. That's another result that we obtain from this, and that is not clear in the existing models that don't capture this process here. So I want to say a few more things about this important parameter R naught. People have already been talking about this for quite a while. Why is this parameter important? It is important because if I neglect this diffusion and transport terms, then I have, think of this as a reaction rate over here. So forget these other guys in the middle here and then pay attention to this part. And let's consider what is the initial rate. The initial rate is R zero, you see I is constant, comes out. S is one at the beginning, you know, there's pretty much no one is infected yet. So the initial rate is this one here. So you look at this and you can think that you can see that this is proportional to the how big R zero is, R naught is with respect to one. If R zero is greater than one, then you have an equation that essentially tells you that the infection rises exponentially fast. And that's a very important observation. The fact that if R naught is greater than one, you are having an exponential growth. Exponential growth is, I think, one of the reasons where the public does not understand the importance of making sure that you try to prevent infection as soon as possible. Because if you let it uncontrollable, then it will go through exponential changes, which means, let's say, doubling every day or something of that type or less, depending on the R naught. And so based on all these things here, you have exponential growth. The good news is that if R naught is less than one, then any initial infection is going to decay and it is very manageable. So that's why this is so important parameter. I should mention also a little bit later on about herd immunity and vaccination. So let's assume that S, which is the susceptible number, at some point becomes equal to S zero, which is essentially people are no longer, the number of people that can be subject to infection is much less because of the process of vaccination. So the initial rate will have that parameter over here. Unfortunately, I don't have it. I haven't put it in there yet, which will make essentially this number less than one because you will multiply R naught by a smaller number than one. As a result of this, essentially you're going to have decay of any initial infection. That's the importance of vaccinations, and that's the importance of essentially what we can consider herd immunity will be the initial value of S, the fraction of people that can be susceptible, which is going to go down to a smaller number if these people are vaccinated or somehow we do other things as well. Conversely, if you don't have vaccination going, one way to make sure that you don't have exponential growth is to do whatever is possible for R naught to be less than one. And that includes many of the things that we're talking about. So let's see how you do that. If you look at R naught, it has these parameters in it. One way to make R naught less than one is to make this density as small as possible. Sure, so that's spatial distancing. In fact, if that density is less than a specific number R naught, this number here could be zero, in which case then you're not going to have any spreading of the infection because the corresponding R naught will be so small, will be less than one. Other ways to control it is by making K naught, K zero smaller than one. To become smaller. This can be done by facial covering. This is a well-known prevention of this. Isolation of infected, increase their circulation, vaccination as well, perhaps it works there as well. So these parameters here tell you what you need to do in order to be able to have something that it is not, the infection is not spreading because it can be less than one. Another way to accomplish this, and I have not seen this in the literature, is if you have fast recovery, in other words, you increase lambda, then what you're going to have is this number is going to go down to less than one as well. So So these are all very important new insights that we get by simply looking at this as a kinetic phenomenon. And another part that we discussed, I alluded to before, is that R naught decreases with the extent of contagion. So at the end of the day, when the contagion is over, the value of R naught is the original value multiplied by essentially how many, one minus R infinity. This is equal to how many, the fraction of susceptible people that are left, which is kind of an interesting new result as well. So I will consider now a number of results, and I'm going to show you a number of curves that come out of that. First of all, first model is a model in which essentially we have what we know, the SIR-like model. In our chemical reaction engineering terminology, this is known as a batch reactor. So there will be no entry or exit of any control volume. The density remains constant, and there are spatially uniform profiles. So there is no variation of space in space, no diffusion. Everything is well mixed. That's the batch reactor model, and that's the SIR model. We'll look at infection, herd immunity, what health policies can do, and also the effect of initial conditions. And I will have something on commuting. How does commuting affect the essentially, let's say you go between home and work, what is the equivalent R naught as a result of that? And then we will discuss the effect of diffusion and how infection waves happen from one place to another. So to just show to you that actually we can do all that, if you remove all these diffusion terms, so you just get them out of the way, then you get these equations, which are simple. They're ordinary differential equations. And you know, again, so you can see the rate of contagion that I mentioned before. It is, you see, it's proportional to I, and it's proportional to these coefficients there. So you can see why this exponentially growing if R naught is greater than one or otherwise. We need to solve this equation. It is very important to notice that you have to have an initial condition of infected, even if it is a very small number. If it is 10 to the minus 3, 10 to the minus 4 probability, you have to have something in order for this to grow. So if there is absolutely zero, it's identical, there is no one infected, it is zero exactly, there is no population, then this equation is not going to go, which means that no matter what R0 is, R0 is. So I think eradicating, if you like, the disease means that there is no one available. This number here is zero, in which case there is no disease to be. Of course, this will be very difficult to accomplish, to have people that have to have eliminate completely anyone who is infected. But that's actually a limiting case. And it's important to know that because of this exponential growth, you have to have some initial seed, if you wish, in order to this to grow. So the solution requires to have an initial, even infinitesimal seed in order to go. And so we will assume that, and we'll put some number, some small number like 10 to the minus 3, 10 to the minus 4 or something. And the problem can be solved analytically. And here are the results. So these are very similar to the, this is the SIR model. Forget the dash curves here because we put them for comparison. So what what you should look at is the infection, the solid lines. So this is how infection starts. Look at the red curve, starts from zero. And then after a while, time here is such that the, about five is about, I mean, about one is about half a month, and five is about, let's say, 2.5 months, right? So this is how infection grows, goes up, goes to a maximum. If you, this assumes you don't change R naught, things remain the same, and then goes down after a maximum, and then it goes down to zero. Oops. This shows the recover people or people who perished. So this moves up and then stabilizes to this point here. And this is the number of susceptible people. They've gone down because of the infection and then stabilized to one point. This starts with 2.5 R naught. So the initial R naught and initial density 10 to the minus 5. This number here, which is about 0.7, 0.68, whatever, for this particular R naught, is what is known as herd immunity. In other words, you have to have, at least in this particular case, 70% of the people infected and recovered in order not to have any further infection, because that's the equilibrium point. However, I wanted to mention a few things about that. This herd immunity is a valid concept only if people do not change the R-naught behavior. If people, if restrictions happen, are relaxed, and instead of R-naught here, you have, instead of 2.5 here, you make it to go to 3 or 4, then there will be another wave that comes in. And I think, therefore, this concept of herd immunity depends very much on what R-naught is and what brought you to that point. So that's an important point to consider. So the reason, the fact that R-naught, the herd immunity is depends on R-naught is shown in this curve here. So forget the green curve, just follow the blue curve. You can see that the higher the R-naught, the higher the requirement for herd immunity, which is over here. So let's say we have R-naught of 6, which is an extraordinarily large number, you are going to have to infect a lot of people in order to be able to reach herd immunity. Conversely, by vaccination, you can lower the herd immunity, because in that case, if you remember, the amount of available people to be infected decreases dramatically. And in this case, the herd immunity changes accordingly. I should mention also another important point, the duration of the infection. So this is a curve that shows how the duration of the infection changes with R-naught. Importantly, you can see that infection is faster, I mean, lasts longer when R-naught is small. So this is actually counterintuitive. You would think that if R-naught is smaller, then the infection lasts a smaller period of time. Actually, that's not true. And the infection can actually be done and be over with, but of course with a much higher impact if R-naught increases. And the duration of the infection is shown here. So as I mentioned before, 10 dimensionless times, these are all dimensionless, corresponds to about 5 months. So you can see an infection wave can last about 10 months, I mean 5 months, in order to be able to be dissipate through the population, through the specific population. So some important results. Herd immunity is a function of R-naught. It always satisfies this condition, namely, it is stable to perturbations, but is not what is known as structurally stable. In other words, if you change R-naught after you reach herd immunity, you are going to have the possibility of creating yet another infection. That's an important part to keep in mind, because I think that we've seen this in the United States, when in a sense we reach an equivalent herd immunity at the end of May, early June, and then people relaxed their behavior, and that created a larger R-naught, and that created a second wave. So this is one way to see this. Let's assume that I have a situation like this. Initially, I have an infection going with R-naught equal to 3. That corresponds to this curve here. And then at some point, people say, well, guys, let's change our behavior and go to 0.8. So from greater than 1, we go down to less than 1. And you can see the effect that the curve is flat, not only flattened, but actually goes down. So this is the infected numbers start going down. And then at some point here, 10, people say, well, we reached a great situation here. We have reached herd immunity, nothing is happening. So let's relax our behavior and go back to our R-naught equal to 3. So what you're gonna see is that exactly because this state is not stable structurally, what you're gonna see is you're gonna see yet another wave coming in. And that's really, in essence, similar to what happened. So one cannot relax the restrictions and have to keep the R-naught as small as possible, unless one has a vaccine, in which case, of course, then you're going to be able to go into a situation that is much more stable. I wanted to mention the effect of initial conditions, because actually that's a fundamental aspect of this. So this is different results. That's the infected fraction as a function of time for different conditions. So this is for 10 to the minus 2, 10 to the minus 3, 4, 5, and so on and so forth. If you compare these curves here, you see that they're identical. The only difference is that they have essentially moved to later times. So what does this mean? What this means is that the initial condition, at least for small numbers, is to simply delay the onset of contagion. In other words, instead of contagion starting over here for this curve, it starts over here for the purple curve. All else being equal, therefore, essentially, the behavior is only controlled by R naught and not by the initial condition. That's an important part. If we essentially have minimized the number of initial conditions, then we are given more time to control the infection. That's really the only effect that it has. That's an important part for people to realize, because we think that, because we think in a linear world and we cannot extrapolate in an exponential way of thinking, we think that if we have fewer initial conditions, we're going to have fewer infected people at the end. The answer, the unfortunate truth is that it's not true, because everything depends on this, this number here or not. That's the most important observation that I don't believe it is known or shared in the by the public, because you think that somehow, you know, if you have small numbers, don't worry about it, things will take care of their own, but I don't think this is true. The truth is that you are given enough time to actually go and influence R naught, and you can influence R naught by spatial distance and many other things in order to be able to do that. And similar is the effect if you insulate a certain area, let's say you're not allowing entrance or exits, provided that, again, you take measures to make sure that you prevent the spread by controlling R naught. Okay. I wanted to also show an example in which you have a commute problem. Let's assume you're at home and there R naught is zero. And then you go to work and then R naught, let's say it's five. So it's a large number. And then you spend a fraction of time at work, let's say 8 hours over 24 hours a day. That's like one third. And then you spend the rest of your time at work. So the question is, if you have that, what is the equivalent effective R naught? Is it zero? Is it five, or is it something in between? And what is this something in between? So we carry out this nice experiment, simulation, and this is what you find. This is R naught at work for five. So you can see this is the curve with the dotted curve. You can see that there is a very sharp infection. Lots of people get infected. This is the green line here. And then essentially, that would be the case if everything was you're constantly at an environment with R naught equal to five. However, because there is back and forth between home and work, the effective R naught is actually not this, obviously, and it's not zero. There is an infection, it's happening right here, but it is much smaller, of course, than this guy here, which is the work time. And also the number of people infected are a lot less than in the previous case. We find that, we can prove that, that the effective R naught is actually the arithmetic average, the mean between the time that you spend at work or in that particular or a different environment and at home in this particular case. So there is an effective R naught, which is proportional to this parameter lambda, and proportional to the R naught at work. So this is something to keep in mind as well. Okay. I will now move to the effects of diffusion, and I'll spend maybe 5 minutes and then I will stop for questions. So we're asking the question, how can diffusion affect the rate of spreading of the infection? So we focus on diffusion only, then there is no advection, so the density remains the same. And we like to understand what is the effect of diffusion. There's a lot of mathematics here. I don't want to bother you with this, but we can show the following. That there are traveling waves. In other words, if you start diffusion, if you allow for diffusion and infection in a particular part then this moves around and it creates a wave, and there is a wave velocity V. It comes up from the solution of these complicated equations. Again, this is, I'm not trying to impress you here that I can move the equations around, but we do get a velocity. And the question then is, what is the effect of diffusion and whether these profiles that you get is the same as in the batch problem. So I'll show you here a simulation. So here is so we start with an infection wave, which starts at one point, and then you can see how it moves. It moves up. So red is the infected part. And then you can see the infection wave that is very similar to the case in which everything was isolated in space and was only a function of time. You can see this nice wave that is going over here. This wave here is the same, it's a straight line. You can see this is time versus distance. So you can see a constant velocity and it keeps moving. Nothing else will happen to it. It will keep moving until it goes through the area. So you started, let's say, a contagion at the infection at one point in let's say at x equal to minus 75 here. And this is moving at different parts of x. So this is how the contagion spreads. And that's actually something which I think is new. It has to do with the fact that the reaction rate or the epidemic is a nonlinear, has a nonlinear term because it's a product of S times I. And this is moving this way. We proved that the effect of diffusion is essentially the same as in the batch problem. So there's a little change here. So you don't have to worry about that. We find that we know how to take care of diffusion. And here, the most important thing is the velocity in dimensional form. So this is dimensional, the velocity, the wave velocity is proportional to the square root of d, and also involves this parameter lambda. Importantly, if d is large, in other words, you have a lot of mobility, then the velocity of the contagion is higher, as we expect. Conversely, if you want this contagion to not spread from one place to another, you have to make this equal to zero. How do you make equal to zero? By making mobility equal to zero. That's essentially the equivalent of a lockdown. If you don't want something to spread spatially, you simply lock down by making d equal to zero, in which case the velocity doesn't go anywhere, and you have a contagion velocity. So the contagion remains stationary in this very specific area. That's why, you know, all the quarantining and all the things that people talk about are essentially reflected in this part here. And also the velocity increases with the intensity, as you would expect. The higher the R naught, the higher the wave velocity. So finally, I should jump here and show you one more final simulation and I'll stop. So the simulation here, the simulation here, let's take the situation in which you have a quadrant. So let's assume that you have four regions of a particular control volume. Let's call it northwest, northeast, southeast, and southwest. And let's assume that you have an R naught, which is 3.5 here. It is 3.5 in the southwest. It is 2 in the northwest and 2 in the southeast. No, this is not intended to simulate the United States. This could be any country or any part of a city that has a, you know, behaviors that are not as high here and here and not there. So we ask the question, if we start the infection here, how it spreads, how this wave spreads. And so this is the static simulations, but I do have a real simulation here to show. So this is how the wave starts, moves in, and then, let me stop here. So it's all very radially symmetric. And the reason it is radially symmetric is because we don't allow any heterogeneity at this point, but we could put heterogeneity if we want. It's important to notice that this is a very stable wave. And the reason for this, and this is why this contagion and this pandemics are so catastrophic, because they are very stable. They are not, they are sweeping pretty much everything on their path. And then after a while, you're going to hit the boundaries where you're going to have a different R naught, because in the other regions, R naught is very small, smaller. And so you can see here that you have a wave that is moving in the place with smaller naught and the other case as well. But because you're going to the southwest area here, this is wave is actually faster. And this is what you're going to see. This is moving faster and it's more intense. And that's basically how the spreading of this contagion is. If we were to make it more realistic, we would put heterogeneity here. We can put, you know, rural versus urban and all that. And that's something one can do. So this is a bit idealistic, but it shows you that you can actually have a wave that spreads. And that essentially is another contribution of this work here. So I'll conclude by understanding the spreading of epidemics can benefit substantially from reaction diffusion analogies. It is very important to talk about spatial densities, and kinetics in this effect, in this way, can naturally incorporate this distancing. Of course, R naught is the important variable, but it's a function of spatial density. I have not seen this before, or process extent. So this is a new result for us. Herd immunity is a function of R naught. I think people may understand this, but I think it's the first time that I understood it better by understanding this processes here. It's a useful concept, but only if R naught does not change. Or if you get vaccination, in which case, of course, it doesn't really matter what your R naught, well, it matters what your R naught is, but probably not too much. Effect of initial conditions is only relevant in the sense that it provides time for people to react and therefore take the necessary measures to reduce R naught. And diffusion is necessary to initiate infection waves and many other things. And this is restricted to three species, but the approach applies to additional species and demographics. So that essentially covers my lecture. I just wanted to open this for discussion. So let me go back to my slide here. So Tiffany, I'm available for conversations or anything like that.
Perfect. Okay. I hadn't seen that simulation before. That was really terrifying. So hopefully we can keep
it's
up.
It's not terrifying. It's illuminating.
It is very intimidating. So I'm hoping that we can keep up the good R naught behavior because
R naught is the most important part.
Exactly. So we have just enough time for about three questions. The first one is, can you explain how you get the diffusion coefficient based on the mobility of people?
Right. So one can do this by, so what is diffusion? Diffusion coefficient, if you think about it, is almost the average of a distance that you, an excursion, right? So you are at a place and you do different excursions. So you're at home and you move around, you move, go to the grocery store, you move somewhere else. And then you estimate what is the average distance that you have gone, square that, and divided by the time over which this average distance, this phenomenon has happened. So let's assume that I move on average every day 3 miles, okay? And then let's assume that this is over a distance of a time of 24 hours, let's say the day. And then I can calculate an equivalent diffusion coefficient by saying 3 miles square divided by 24 hours. And that will give me a diffusion coefficient. If I were to, let's say, I am a traveling salesman and I move around or a traveling person, then I can have the equivalent of this, let's say over a week, and find out how many miles I have gone through planes and all that, square it, divide by the time over which this happened. That will give you a number, and this number is a diffusion coefficient. So this is something that you can put in there. We actually have used it to model the influenza of the plague. There was a plague back in the ancient times. And we have used this model to come up with an equivalent diffusion coefficient, and the same thing we've done for the SARS epidemic in 2008, whatever it was. Mm-hmm. And we come up with some interesting numbers. Yeah, they're in our paper.
Very fascinating. Thank you, Yannis. Okay, the next question comes from Risa. Do you think that testing a larger number of the population can isolate the infection portion of the population to suppress the virus and lower the infection rate?
Well, isolating infected people is clearly an important part, right? Because then you're not, then essentially you accomplish two things. In terms of infection, you don't, the concentration of people that are infected and they are in, say, circulation for others is going to be very small, right? So this number, essentially you decrease that number. You don't have the waves that I mentioned before because that corresponding diffusion effect is not going to be there for those people who are, they will have a different diffusion coefficient. Right. Yes, the answer is true. The question is, how much it costs. At the end of the day, it's an issue of economics and an issue of, convenience, if you wish. If we had a way by which, just like we brush our teeth, we would know whether we're infected or not every day. go from there. I mean, that would be an ideal situation, right?
That makes sense.
I am at my office today, as you can see, And in order to come to campus, I had to declare that I don't have a fever, that I don't sneeze, that I don't have a runny nose or anything like that, which is kind of a poor man's identification of whether you're infected or not. If I had a better, but definitely, yeah, sure. I mean, the more testing, the better, for sure.
Right. Okay. Thank you. All right. We have just enough time for one last question. Have results or your formula differed at all from when you initially created the model back in May?
Yes, absolutely. When I started in the May, I was a bit perplexed, actually. So I was looking at some of these models and I was scratching my head and trying to understand why are they doing that? And then I said, well, let's take a different approach. But the more I was thinking about it, the more I realized that there is interesting things here that people can benefit from a different way. And we'll see, so we send our paper for review. Maybe people will say, this is the best thing since sliced bread, or people can say, well, this is all nonsense and we don't really care too much about what he have to say. But my most, the message that I want to send, in addition to, I think, potential benefits from this particular approach, is that engineers can bring a lot more to the table. I think we have been somehow left out of the conversation for reasons that I'm not sure why. Maybe we intimidate people by putting too many equations there, and I hope that it did not have this effect on you today. But clearly, I think we can offer tremendous, tremendous, tremendous value. And I think because, at the end of the day, the kinetics and the epidemics and the spreading of this, there is a fundamental biology part to it, but a lot of it has to do with engineering in the sense of how we understand it. If you take the medical treatment separately, which actually that also is becoming more and more engineering oriented, I think you can learn a lot. And I'm very much a proponent of using all these engineering tool sets that we have to solve big important problems, including problems that have human dimensions in some sense, like of the type that I described here.
Absolutely. I absolutely agree with that. We just had a last question pop in from Istanbul. Do you have about 30 more seconds?
I have as much time as you want.
Excellent. Excellent. So this question is, can we definitively say when an infected person starts to infect others and how long it continues?
Now, that is not something that I can say from this model, actually, because we don't look at the, this is a biological question, and depends on the individuals, right? Some individuals may be, I don't know if we understand completely how, the spreading works. Here, we assume that we don't differentiate between people who are infected and at what stages. You can do that by simply making this even more fine-grained and introducing additional populations, if you wish. But I think there's some biology that the way the human reacts, that I'm not so sure that we are. I certainly am not the person to be able to be able to express an opinion on it. However, in our series of lectures that we have on Viterbi versus pandemics, there is a biology, a couple of biology lectures as well. And maybe people there, Professor Pin Wang will talk about vaccines. Professor Rich Roberts talks about how to use protein engineering for all that. So yeah, it's something that one can potentially answer. It's a fascinating subject.
Perfect. And that was actually the perfect transition to my conclusion. If you are an alumni and would like access to the full lecture, Viterbi versus Pandemics, that Dean Yortsos just mentioned, please email me at tte@usc.edu for exclusive alumni access. Thank you so much again, Dean Yortsos. It's always a pleasure watching you present, and we're so grateful that you can share your research with us. This webinar was recorded and should be posted in about 24 hours. Thank you to all for joining us this afternoon. And as we see here at USC, fight on. Thank you, everyone. Have a great rest of your week.